microphone wasn't on when I said that. Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome. What a delight on this gorgeous Lord's Day that we can gather and worship our Lord together. We'll pass the basket in a minute. There's some contact cards in here, so I hope you'll take a moment to fill it out and drop it in the basket as well. So there's a little story about this woman, Rita, who the weather was beautiful. You know, she says, oh, let's have a picnic. I'm going to invite all the neighbors to come to my house and we'll just enjoy a cookout. Well, even though her neighbors said, what can we bring? You know, what can we do to help you? She just insisted on doing everything. And by everything, I mean she cooked all the food. She decorated the table. She just... everything. She left no detail left to anyone else or to chance. So Saturday comes, neighbors and friends begin to gather, and then when they all sit down to tables with their, you know, plates piled high, she turns to her seven-year-old daughter and says, honey, why don't you give the blessing? Well, you know, she got real big-eyed at that moment, and she says, but Mom, I don't know what to say. And she says, well, of course you do. She says, we say the blessing all the time. Just think back to you know, one of the, something that you heard me say this week. Yep. So the little girl nods, and so she, you know, closes her eyes, and she folds her hands, and she says, dear God, why on earth did I invite all these people to my house? Well, relationships can be tricky, right? With friends, with neighbors, even or especially with loved ones sometimes. And we're going to close out our How to Become a Better Human sermon series as we look today on how we can build better relationships. So as we begin this time of worship, let us pray. Lord of love, as we enter into worship this day, fill us with your Spirit. Embolden us to love as Jesus loved, so as to better our relationships with all people we encounter. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. I'm glad you guys are here. We have some guests visiting us today. So as we sing our opening song, I'd like to invite everyone to stand and greet those around you with a warm welcome. Please stand.
Thank you.
for everyone to just bring their awareness to a moment, to a situation in your past that's been hard to let go of, or maybe a person in your past who you need to forgive. Scripture tells us that God can transform us and make us more forgiving if we surrender. And so as we sing this next song, let us remember that we are called to become who God tells us we are to become. In Christ's name we pray and sing this morning. Amen. To love better. Scripture tells us in the scripture we're going to hear today that our love will cover a multitude of sins. And as we grow in love, we have to also grow in forgiveness, right? A forgiven heart must be a forgiving heart. So right before the scripture we're going to hear today in 1 Peter, This entire chapter is really helpful in ministry, for sure. I'm sure you've read it more than once. But yeah, exactly. And mine is very highlighted, if you can see the pink on mine. The whole chapter is very pink. But a little before the part we're going to hear today, there's this line that says, to arm yourselves with the same mind, that mind of Christ that suffered. And then it says, for we have spent enough of our past lifetime in doing the will of the Gentiles, when we walked in lewdness, lust, drunkenness, revelries, drinking parties, and abominable idolatries. And then it says, in regard to these, they think it strange that you do not run with them in the same dissipation, speaking evil of you. So have you ever tried to, last week we talked about boundaries, have you ever tried to set boundaries with someone and then they started rumors about you or were unkind to you? I don't know if you guys read my article that came out in May, but mine was all about forgiveness. And there's this line in there that I shared by George Bernanos that says that the desire to pray is a prayer in itself. I love that, because it reminds us what God can do with very little. And so the desire to forgive someone, God can work with that. God can do a lot with that. So our prayer for today, as God is trying to change us, is that we grow in love and surrender, because as much as God has loved us, we're called to love others too, especially those who have wronged us. Let us pray. God of light and of love, you have loved us. And so we ask that you increase our love for one another, increase our patience for one another. Sometimes, Lord, it feels like we are encountering the most frustrating people, be it in traffic, in the grocery store, or even in our own families. But as we are called to change, Lord, we ask that you help us. Help us to grow in maturity. Help us to see our part in our past, and help us to forgive ourselves as well as other people. And we ask that you help us to lay all of our burdens at your feet with complete trust that you have our backs. For it is in Jesus' name that we pray and sing this morning. Amen.
Lay down your burden.
Isn't it wonderful that we can come before the Lord just as we are? We don't have to be perfect. We don't have to have it all together. So often we think that we do. And the truth is we don't. We can come as we are because God loves us and accepts us as we are, who we are. And the good news, he doesn't leave us there. You know, he works to make us even better each and every day. As John Wesley would say, going on to perfection. As we come to our time of prayer, just a few things to lift up this day. I don't know if you got the word, but Veronica Pritchard passed away back in the mid-2000s. She was your associate pastor when Tim Neustifter was here. So 2006, 7, 8, something around in there. And so we just want to lift her family up in a prayer. Also this week, Bill Sumrall and I will head off to annual conference. He is your lay delegate, and so prayers for traveling mercies, because Bill's going to be my ride or die. He'll be hanging on, you know, like that. And just pray for our conference as we make whatever decisions there are to make and vote on and those kinds of things. Sam Bijek had a birthday this last Friday. And Bill, you and Kim, was it 19 years? What day? Tuesday? Monday? Tuesday. So happy anniversary to the two of you. So we praise God for these celebrations. So let us now go before the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, forgive us when the last thing on our mind is turning to you in prayer as we move through our day. Open our eyes to your creation, to your handiwork, to your fingerprints on all of creation, on the people in our homes, and on the strangers in the streets. Thank you, Lord, for your unconditional love and unrestricted forgiveness. Help us to live lives that become the gospel, so much so that your love infiltrates our very being. Not a superficial love or an accommodating love, but a love that covers a multitude of sins. And through the indwelling of your Holy Spirit, make us mindful of the gifts that you have given to each of us. Help us to use these gifts not for our own gain, but for your glory. And may our gifts benefit not just our family or our work, but may they be used to build our church, grow our community, and help and serve the people of greatest need that you place in our path. And now, Lord, may love be on our heart. May generosity come from our hands. May hospitality be on our mind. And may kindness be on our lips. This we pray in the name of Jesus who taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, as we close out our series on how to become a better human, we're going to look at relationships. And 1 Peter is a great place to look, some pretty good advice. And Elizabeth is right. It's a great read. It's not very long. It's only a few chapters. 1 Peter is, anyway, it's just four chapters. So if you're looking for something to devote on this week, you can take a chapter a week and get some pretty good food for thought. So we're going to use 1 Peter chapter 4, beginning at verse 8, as our guide to better relationships this morning. So Peter writes, "Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. And each of you should use whatever gifts you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. Let me read that again. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so with the strength God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. And to him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, still the busyness of our minds and open our hearts to you that we may hear your word for us this day. Amen. Well, I think when it comes to relationships, we have probably raised an entire generation that thinks that the bachelor is how you are to find, you know, your soulmate, your one and only. I remember when it came out, hit the airways 22 years ago in 2002. Our daughters were in high school and in middle school at the time, and we were big fans, and we would watch. And the idea was, and still is, that this eligible bachelor and now even bachelorette, the network finds 25 or so suitable women for this, you know, for the bachelor. And they go on all these exotic dates. They have several rounds of group dates and one-on-one dates and rose ceremonies and eliminations. For years, the girls and I, every Monday night, you know, Rusty was out of town, and we would, you know, eat. We never eat in front of the TV, but we would eat in front of the TV on Monday nights. So we could watch The Bachelor, and we would tune in to see who was going to be eliminated. We would pass judgment on who got a rose and who didn't, and, you know, who went home and who stayed. We oohed and aahed over these exotic date locations that they would go on. We laughed as the drama escalated, and it was not a good show if there weren't tears, and I promise you, there were plenty of tears. Now even sometimes the bachelor or the bachelorette will be in tears. And so there was always lots of fun. We would spend the week before the finale, you know, debating on who might get a proposal and who's going to get sit home. I mean, And then it never surprised us after the finale when we might be standing in the grocery store, you know, and you see People magazine or a tabloid that then is, you know, dishing on the breakup. Because, you know, once the cameras are turned off, once the producers are no longer, arranging these exotic dates and it has to become a real relationship, it's not surprising that there's usually a breakup pretty soon to follow. In fact, wasn't it just not too long ago that the Golden Bachelor and Teresa broke up on Good Morning America, you know, announced their divorce after just getting married in January? And that's what we think. That's been our guideline, our standard for the last 22 years about what dating is like. We've raised an entire generation thinking that if you don't fall in love in 3 episodes or less, that there must be something wrong with you, you know? If your person is not taking you out on these exotic dates, then he or she must be really boring, you know? And if you really want the evening to go well, bring a rose. You know, that's what we've raised kids to believe this day. But there's more to relationships than that. I promise there is, and as we look at today's scripture, we're going to see four really good building blocks to having better relationships, and not just with loved ones, not just with family members, but better relationships with all people. These are good building blocks for any kind of relationship. So let's take a look. All right, so Peter is the author of this letter. And from start to finish, this letter is one of hope and courage. The letter was intended for new Christians, and so he wanted to give them words of encouragement. He didn't want their relationship with God or each other to become stale. So he gives them these words of encouragement in order to build better relationships. Peter believed that if we could have better human relationships on earth, then we could have a better understanding of what our relationship should be with God. You know, the two greatest commandments were to love God and love people. Love God and love people. And so Peter is trying to help us do just that. So the first building block that he suggests to a better relationship is to love deeply. Love deeply. Verse 8 says, above all, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. Now, this is not a love that seeks to possess, but a love that seeks to give on equal footing. Love that atones for the sins of another. Love that keeps no record of wrong. Love that is unconditional. Love that endures like the strength of a marathon runner. Now, I know you're going to be surprised, but I am not a marathon runner. This is not a body of a marathon runner. But I actually have friends who have run marathons. Anybody run a marathon in here? Nope. I thought for sure Jonathan would raise his hand. Definitely not. Well, from what I understand, It is just as much a mental race as it is a physical race. And they say once you hit about mile 13, everything in you is telling you to quit. You know, your feet hurt, your legs sting, your lungs feel like they are about to burst out of your chest, and you got to get your head around it. You've got to convince yourself that you need to continue to put one foot in front of the other if you're going to make it to the finish line. And so at about mile 13, it becomes a mental race as much as a physical race. Well, the same is true when it comes to better relationships. Sometimes everything in us is telling us to quit on this relationship, to walk away because of their behavior, bad decisions, bad actions, sins that have hurt you deeply, a breach of trust perhaps. But if we can love deeply, in the same way we can also forgive deeply, then we have a wonderful building block to a better relationship, even if there has been a significant breach of trust. Next thing Peter tells us is to practice hospitality. That's verse 9. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Treat each other kindly. Don't act like what you do is a great bother or a great effort. Give of yourself in a way that shows that you care more about the other person than you do about yourself. Some years ago, Rusty and I were eating at this Chinese restaurant that was in kind of a strip center. So the glass, you know, windows, you could see everything that was going on in the parking lot. And there was this little couple with a new baby and one of the carriers that was eating there. And it was a typical summer day, you know, when things heat up, then all of a sudden the rains come. Well, the rains came. And the dad runs out to the parking lot and gets the car and brings it up closer to the door, and he has an umbrella. So then he holds the umbrella over his wife and child as she puts the baby in the carrier on the driver's side. Then he walks her around to the passenger side and puts her in the car. And then finally, he puts the little Winnie the Pooh umbrella over his head. You know, that's what it means to care for someone, to practice hospitality in a way that you worry more about their well-being sometimes. And that's important in building good relationships. The third building block to a better relationship is to be generous. In verse 10, it says, each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others faithfully, administering God's grace. Be generous, not in a gift-giving kind of way, but in a godly kind of way. Use your gifts that you've been given to God's glory. Don't hold back. Be a blessing to one another. Give of yourself unselfishly, using the gifts that God gave you. Do it for the good of the relationship. If you cook, then cook. If you clean, then clean. And don't keep score about who does what. Just do it. And last but not least, speak kindly. Verse 11, if anyone speaks, he should do so as one speaking the very words of God. Boy, that's pretty powerful because, there have been things that have been pretty sharp-edged coming out of my mouth sometimes, and I'm thinking God probably wouldn't say that in that way. He'd probably say it a little nicer. So how are you speaking to the ones that you love the most? There was a couple that was in my church, Jane and Leonard. And Leonard was in the hospital, and I had gone to see him. And Leonard had some memory issues. And while I was there, his lunch tray came. And he was, eating his lunch. And on it was some broccoli. And he asked Jane, would you like some broccoli? No, honey, I don't think I want any broccoli. You go ahead and eat it. I'll eat later. Well, a few minutes later, he looped around to the same question. Jane, would you like some broccoli? No, honey, I don't think so. I'm not hungry right now. You go ahead and eat it. Probably a dozen times, Leonard asked Jane the very same question. And I was so impressed that each and every time that she answered him with the same kindness that she did the very first time. Leonard didn't remember that he had asked her 10, 11 other times, and she treated him with the wonderful kindness. So I encourage us to all speak kindly, especially when you're mad. How do you speak to your loved ones when you're mad? Some years ago, I was, I don't know if you remember, your associate pastor, Larry Norman. Larry and I had to go to a meeting, one of those Methodist meetings up in Arkansas. And we were living in New Orleans at the time. I had packed my car because I had our youngest daughter and her best friend that I needed to drop off, pick up Larry, and then Larry and I were going on to this meeting in Arkansas. Get the car packed up, loaded, and it won't go. It won't turn over. It won't do anything. Well, I walk inside, and I told Rusty, I said, I've got to take your car to Arkansas. And he said, well, what am I going to do for a car, you know? Wrong answer. That was the wrong answer. Because, I mean, Jamie had a car, so, I mean, he really had a car. So it wasn't like I was leaving him stranded. But that was the wrong answer. Men, do not try that at home. And I said, well, I can't take Jamie's car because it's not going to have enough room to put everything. So, you know, he gives me his keys, and I load his car up, and off I go. And I'm just mad. I'm mad. I'm mad for 2 days. And about the second day, Larry Norman goes, have you talked to Rusty yet? And I said, no. I said, I don't have anything nice to say to him. And I said, so I'm not going to call him when I'm all mad. And Larry says, Ariel, you need to fix this. And I said, Larry, it's not broken. I'm just mad. You know, and when you're in a good, solid relationship, you can be mad. You know, you still need to watch what you say, but you can be mad. It wasn't broken. It didn't need to be fixed. I just had to get over myself. I mean, that was the reality. So speak kindly. Speak as if the words that are coming out of your mouth are from the mouth of God. If they're not, you better go get some soap. Wash that thing out. So here's just some rules of engagement for fighting fair. Just a little extra food for thought. Doesn't cost you anything. No name calling. Don't exaggerate with always and never. Like, you always leave your dishes laying around, or you never pick your clothes up off the floor. Those aren't useful at all. They don't do you any good. Don't bring up past mistakes. You know, a good memory really will not help you in an argument. Don't, if you're married, don't use the word divorce in the middle of an argument. It's like throwing a bomb in the middle of an argument. It makes people feel like now they are hanging on for dear life. Keep your cool as much as possible. Talk it out. Rusty calls me. We don't hardly argue at all. We've run out of things after 42 and a half years to argue about. But when we did argue, Rusty used to call me Ms. Pac-Man. You know how Ms. Pac-Man, you know, goes, and so, you know, that's how we would argue. You know, I would just follow him around, and another thing, you know, talking it out meant like I was doing all the talking until I was quiet enough for him to share what he thought about it. And then never let go at the same time. This has probably been the best thing for our marriage, because there have been times that our marriage has been held by a thread, a very thin thread. And as long as someone is still holding on to that thread, our marriage has hung together. So don't let go of that relationship. Don't both of you let go of a relationship at the same time. So my prayer for you, my prayer for me, my prayer for us as a community of faith is that we will become better humans as we work to have better relationships with one another. Not just our loved ones, but with the people you sit beside in Sunday school and in church. And we can do that by speaking kindly, by being generous, by practicing hospitality, and most of all, by loving deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. Amen, amen and amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you. We thank you for the people that you have put in our lives, some more difficult than others. So help us, Lord, to build better relationships with all people, those that we love and those that are sometimes hard to love. This we pray in your name. Amen. We witnessed no greater love than the love that Christ has for us. He showed us what true love of others looked like as he was willing to give of his life for the atonement of our sins. There is no greater love than that. That is a deep love that truly covers a multitude of sins. And we are reminded of that love each and every time we gather around this table. For we are reminded of the night that the Lord gathered with his disciples, where he took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this as often as you eat of it in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, blessed it. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Almighty God, send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood, that we might be refreshed and renewed, our eyes opened in such a way that we can love others in the same way that you love us. This, Lord, we pray in your name. Amen. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we are reminded that many as we are still one body bound together by in Christ's love. But just like this bread, we must be broken open, just like the cup poured out, so that we might be made whole. And the cup of blessing in which we share, is it not a means of sharing in all the blessings that Christ has in store for us? At this service, we share from a common loaf, but we have individual cups, and if you prefer pre-prepared communion, we have that as well. This table is open to all people. You don't have to be a member of the church. You don't have to be United Methodist. You need only to believe in Jesus Christ, for this is his table. And at the Lord's table, everyone is welcome. So come and freely receive.
There's more in the back if you need one. Just raise your hand and we'll throw you one. Our hymn of thanksgiving will be number 601, Thy Word is a Lamp. That's number 601 in your red hymnals.
Forever is wandering.
are some great ways to connect into the life of the church. If you've got a teenager hanging around your house tomorrow, there is a lake day. They are going to some body of water near Dry Prong. So all the details are right here on the insert on the table. They're to be here at 9:30 sharp. So that's what it says. Next week, if you've got a kiddo, a younger kid up through fifth grade, there's going to be a play day at the activity zone at the mall. So all that information is there as well. The registration is open for Vacation Bible School. You can go to our Facebook page. There's a link. Or you can go to our website, www.fumca.org. And get your child registered for Vacation Bible School. Please be sure to do that before all our, because it's going public. We want our kids to be able to participate too, but you got to get them signed up. And then we need volunteers. You'll see a lovely display at the end of the hall where you can sign up to volunteer. And the next two Sundays, I mean, you should be here every Sunday, but the next two Sundays, there's some really neat things. We're going to honor all our men next week on Father's Day. And then the following week, which is the 23rd or something like that, we're going to have another Songs of Our Faith Sunday. In both worship services, we'll have some vocalists and
a few strings
in here, as well as vocalists and strings in the 11 o'clock service as well. So it's all on joy. What did you say we were going to call it? I forgot now.
The joy of the Lord.
The joy of the Lord. So it's all happy songs. What a great thing. See, she's so smart. She's just my right hand. So the joy of the Lord is the theme of all the songs that we will be singing and hearing. So you are going to want to have some joy, 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 joy down in your heart.
Yes.
Nice. All right. Take it away, Elizabeth.
All right. Let's stand and sing together. Thank you.
joy in your heart, ready to be a better human, to build better relationships where you work, where you play, and where you live. And may the peace of God be with you this day and forevermore. Amen.